Very good morning, all of you. This is Professor M.C. Nataraja from the Department of Civil Engineering, MSRIT. I welcome all the students for my session 8, and I'll be teaching Design of Steel Structural Elements 18CV61 for the 6th semester students. Well, students, in fact, in the previous classes, I was discussing about plastic method of structural analysis, what is the importance of plastic method of analysis, and in what way plastic method is advantageous compared to working stress method of analysis. And also, just in the previous class, I discussed about the importance of the work equation, which is derived from the principle of virtual work. And also, I was discussing about the different theorems in connection with plastic method of analysis. So we have seen the upper bound theorem, lower bound theorem, uniqueness theorem, and what are the fundamental assumptions need to be satisfied so in order to do the plastic analysis. And as I mentioned, it is extremely difficult to satisfy all the three conditions in some of the complicated structures. Now, if the problem is very simple, so the three conditions automatically get satisfied, and whether you use the upper bound theorem or the lower bound theorem, we have only one solution, and that is what is going to be the ultimate load from the point of analysis. And in fact, I discussed one example of a simply supported beam subjected to central concentrated load, and we have derived the expression for what is the ultimate load carrying capacity of the simply supported beam. In fact, that ultimate load W is equal to 4 MP by L. Now, for a given span, if we have certain beam suggested, say which is ISMB 300 or 400 over a span of 3 meter or 4 meter, and what is the ultimate load the beam can carry as a central concentrated load can be determined from this formula. So W is equal to 4 MP by L, where MP is the plastic section capacity, the plastic capacity of the section, and that is equal to plastic section modulus multiplied by the yield strength of the material. So in fact, I discussed in greater details in the previous class as far as these things are concerned. Anyway, it is the same derivation. So this is where the simply supported beam of span L comes into picture. So the load is exactly acting at the center. So L by 2 and L by 2 is what the distance of the load from the two supports. And this is the bending moment diagram. And we know that the maximum value of the bending moment, the free bending moment, is WL by 4. But at the time of collapse, the load W reaches the value WU. And that is the reason it is WL by 4. So we can calculate the MP with the help of this bending moment diagram. And also, we have seen that the mechanism for the simply supported beam is something like this. So with two mechanical hinges at the support, where the two supports are able to rotate as the load is increased gradually. And when load W becomes maximum, we have seen that one plastic hinge is going to form exactly at the center where the load is acting. So with three hinges, two being the mechanical hinges and one being the plastic hinge with the capacity MP, so the beam transforms itself into a mechanism. So with this mechanism, so how to determine the ultimate load? Now, if you use the concept of lower bound theorem, in fact, there is only one approach, because all the three conditions we are satisfying simultaneously in this problem. Now, if you go by the equilibrium method, so for the equilibrium method, we need to use the bending moment diagram. So I again caution the students, whenever you are solving the problem by equilibrium method, so we need to use the bending moment diagram. So this is also called as the static method. Mechanism method is also sometimes referred to as the kinematic method, and for this method we need to use the mechanism. So this is what the mechanism for the to determine the ultimate load based on the kinematic approach, and this is what the bending moment diagram you need to use it if you are using the static method of analysis, which is also called as the equilibrium method. Now, from the bending moment diagram, so this is what the bending moment diagram. Just now I told you that the ultimate moment is WL by 4. So WL by 4, and that is equal to MP. So there is no other alternative. So simply satisfy the equilibrium equation as far as the bending moment diagram is concerned. So we satisfy all the conditions. So with this, so W is equal to 4 MP by L. So MP is equal to WL by 4, or W is equal to 4 MP by L. Now how to get the same answer, W is equal to 4 MP by L, based on the kinematic approach. So in the kinematic approach, so we should have the mechanism. So kindly see here. So there is a external load W, which displaces by an amount delta. So thereby the load does the work, and that is what the external work done by the load. And what is the internal work? The internal work is nothing but the internal energy absorbed by the plastic hinge when it undergoes rotation. But that plastic hinge has got a capacity, so that is what is referred to as the internal load. So the moment MP and this particular portion carrying that moment undergoes a combined deformation of theta plus theta equal to 2 theta. So with this, external work is nothing but W. So the delta is this one, and that is nothing but the L by 2 into theta, considering this triangle to be an arc of a circle. So we have this delta considered to be the arc, and of course this is the radius. So these two things are, though it is slightly different as far as triangle is concerned, but all these deformations are very, very small. So taking that into consideration, so what the horizontal distance we have as L by 2, and even the displaced length, so they are assumed to be equal, and with that delta is equal to L by 2 theta. So W into L by 2 theta equal to W L theta by 2. So this being the external work done by the external load. And the internal work, as I mentioned, so we have the accumulation of the bending at this particular point, the concentrated bending moment being the plastic moment, and that plastic moment MP, and that particular portion of the hinge, though hinge has got certain length, I told you for all practical purposes it is treated as a point, and that hinge undergoes a total rotation of 2 theta. So MP, the internal load, being the moment into 2 theta, so we have MP 2 theta. So equating the external work and the internal work, so we have this equation. So from this, W is equal to 4 MP by L. The same thing, we got it by the static method, so which is based on the bending moment diagram. So whenever you have such type of simple problems, even in the examination, I request the students to first draw the bending moment diagram and then work out the ultimate load. That is where the equilibrium method comes into picture. Otherwise, try to identify the possible mechanism as far as that beam is concerned, based on the end conditions and also based on the type of the load, whether it is concentrated load or UDL. So with that, the ultimate load on the beam can be determined. So with this concept, let us try to take a few more problems. So with the different end conditions and different loading conditions, so that we will be able to extend this concept of static method and the kinematic method to different types of simply supported beam problems. Now let us take the problem number 2. In fact, it is same as the previous problem as far as the load is concerned. So it is not simply supported, it's an encastered beam, built up beam, or the fixed beam. So the two ends, you can see here, it is fixed. Here also it is fixed. Otherwise, the things are exactly same as the previous problem. Students, in this particular problem, we have two types of bending moment diagram. So one bending moment diagram exclusively for the external load, and that is where the free bending moment diagram comes into picture. And the variation of that free bending moment diagram, as you know, it is triangular in nature, because the load is concentrated and the variation of the moment is linear. So this triangular part is the bending moment diagram over the entire span for this external load. And here there is a fixed moment, and here also there is a fixed moment. And in fact, we have the concept of redistribution of moment in this particular case, which I will be explaining in the subsequent slides. Now kindly see the moment here when it reaches MP, and here again we have the scope for the moment to reach MP. So these are the two end moments, MP, MP, being a fixed moments, and over the entire span, so that fixed moment is constant. So thereby, the bending moment diagram for the fixed moment, for this fixed beam, is rectangular in nature. And also we know that the free bending moment diagram, if you take it as positive due to the load effect, the fixed moment is in the opposite direction. The effect of the fixed moment is in the opposite direction of the moment because of the external load. So whatever the rectangular part I have, it is the fixed moment, and whatever I have as a triangle is the free bending moment diagram. So one is positive and another is negative, and kindly see wherever there is an overlap. So this is what the overlapping part of the triangle, overlapping part of the rectangle. So these two gets cancelled out because the nature of the bending moments are opposite in nature. So resulting in, so this variation of the fixed moment from the end up to some point, and this is what the point which is referred to as the point of inflection in the bending profile. Otherwise, this is the point of contraflexure where the moment changes its sign. So the negative moment will become almost zero, and if you go further, so positive moment starts, and the positive moment is maximum here. A similar type of situation will be having onto the other side. Now, what is the equilibrium equation you are going to establish here? Now, if you take the bending moment diagram into consideration here, so what is this value of the bending moment? So the bending moment as determined from the free bending. So this is what the maximum value of the bending moment from the consideration of W. So that is nothing but WL by 4, same as the previous value, where W being the working load becomes the ultimate load. So WL by 4. But at the time of failure, when mechanism is going to form, so we have the statical admissible bending moment diagram, and this is what the statical admissible bending moment diagram. And also I told you, so here we have the net positive moment being the maximum, and that is the location where plastification happens. One plastic hinge is going to come, and the moment is MP, fully plastified capacity. And at the end also you see this is the moment being maximum, and you take any other sections in the negative bending moment profile, so they are less than this maximum value. So obviously this maximum value is again the ultimate value of the moment at which one more plastic hinge is likely to form. So this is again onto the other side, so we have the same explanation. So this is what the plastic moment capacity. So this plastic moment capacity MP and this plastic moment capacity MP, so they are all same. But when you come to the center from the point of equation of equilibrium, so this depth is MP, and also I told you this depth. So this depth is again MP because this is the positive MP. But if you come downwards in terms of magnitude, this is the negative MP. So totally MP positive and MP negative means we have two times of MP. So our objective is to get an expression for MP or to get an expression for W. So obviously the equation of equilibrium is such that, so from the bending moment diagram, so this ordinate of the positive and this ordinate of the negative, if I add it, it is 2MP. So that's what I have mentioned here, 2MP, and that should be equal to, what is this ordinate as a function of the load? So this is what the ordinate as a function of the moment, 2MP. The same ordinate as a function of W is nothing but the bending moment from the free bending moment diagram, treating the same way as a simply supported member. So that is WL by 4. So therefore WL by 4 is equal to 2MP. So with this W is equal to 8MP by L, or you can also calculate what is MP. So MP is equal to WL by 8. So that's all the information you need to remember. So getting such type of simple problems in the examination is not that likely, but what I expect the students to remember these values. Now see, in a continuous beam, so in a continuous beam of 3 span or 4 span, so if you happen to get a continuous span, a continuous intermediate span of a continuous beam of say length is L, again subjected to the load W, since the beam is continuous, so we have the end moments. So obviously that individual member of a continuous beam behaves like a fixed beam. So in such situation, even without doing a simple calculation based on the fundamentals, we can simply remember that. So if MP is given for that intermediate beam of a continuous beam with this configuration, so that is WL by 8. Or if you want to determine what is the ultimate load that causes the failure of that intermediate beam of a continuous beam, then that W is equal to 8MP by L. So because the intermediate beam in a continuous beam, so the end behaves as a fixed member. So that is where the value what we have calculated here can be used in the analysis of continuously. So in fact, in the examination, so we get a few problems as a part of continuous beam, maybe from the point of analysis, or maybe to even say how the analysis can be drawn and different methods can be applied, either the equilibrium method or the mechanism method, depending on the situation. Now, how this answer of W8MP by L can be obtained from the second approach, which is the mechanism method, so kinematic method. So for that, we need the bending moment, we need the mechanism diagram. And also when you do the analysis by the static method, which is the equilibrium method, so this is what the bending moment diagram we have considered. So thereby two equations of the two fundamental conditions we have satisfied. So one is the equation of equilibrium, so another is the value of the bending moment anywhere along the span at the most can be equal to MP, but in all other sections it should be less than MP. So that condition is automatically satisfied. Now see the positive moment, it is MP, and wherever you see along the length of the beam where we have the positive moment, the value of the positive moment is less than MP. Now similarly, see the portion where you have the negative bending moment variation, the maximum value is again MP. But you take any other sections, so where you have the distribution of the negative moment, the value is less than MP. So automatically the condition of maximum MP existing only at those salient locations where hinges can likely to form, but in all other locations the moment is less than MP, so that has been satisfied. And that is the reason we are using this bending moment diagram for the further analysis, and with that we got the value W is equal to 8MP by L. Now we need to ensure whether plastic hinges are going to form at those locations. Yes, it has to happen. So that is what the condition we need to satisfy. So since this is equal to MP, so plastic hinge has to form, and that is what I have shown. And this is the positive bending moment being maximum, so one more hinge is likely to come here. And similarly at the left end also, so we have one hinge is likely to form. So obviously with the bending moment diagram being considered, I can assure you that the beam is undergoing failure in this fashion when the load is further increased beyond W. So when the load is further increased beyond W, the beam is not going to offer any resistance, and the resistance of the beam as moment is also not going to exceed beyond MP. Instead, the beam undergoes continuous deformation, and at these locations, so where you have the central hinge, so that particular portion undergoes an infinite rotation leading to the collapse. And that collapse condition of the structure, which is the beam, initial beam, is what is referred to as the mechanism. So final condition or the final situation of the beam when it is at the verge of undergoing collapse, where it is not able to offer any resistance to the load, is what is referred to as the mechanism. So since the beam is undergoing failure, and this is the beam failure pattern or the beam mechanism. Now the conditions are satisfied, so what the load I have got it by static method is correct. Now if I want to apply the mechanism method, so I need to again write an equilibrium equation based on the work principle, and of course I need to consider the mechanism itself from the point of analysis. So this is what the likely mechanism. Even without knowing the distribution of the bending moment, I can make out that since it is a fixity point, one hinge is likely to come, and this is another fixity, the support, so where one hinge can be expected, and this is the point where the load is acting, and obviously we can expect one hinge. In fact, in one of the earlier classes, so I told you what are all the various locations where a plastic hinge is likely to come. So hinge will definitely come on all those locations where you have the concentrated load, and of course you have the support in the form of a fixity, so you do get the plastic hinge. And sometimes along the length of the beam, if there is a variation in the the second moment of area, so what do you call that second moment of area, so that is the moment of inertia of the section. So the moment of inertia of the section may be assumed to be constant, and that is equal to say 2i, and maybe for another portion if you assume that to be equal to I, So there is a drastic change in the cross section of the beam at the point comes into picture. At that point, there may be a load, or load may be at any other point. So that's not the issue. But when there is a sudden change in the cross section from 2i to i, or from 0.5i to 2i, or whatever it is, that is the location where the plastic hinge is likely to come. So they are all the probable locations. And of course, in a multi-story building where you have more than two members meeting, and that particular point also behaves like a joint, and we have the joint mechanism, and that location also plastic hinge is likely to come. But as far as your current problem of fixed beam is concerned, so three plastic hinges will come. And this also I have discussed in the earlier class, that the indeterminacy for this beam is two. So two unknowns here, because we don't have the horizontal force here, and also the external load being vertical. So we have four unknowns, two at one end and two at another end, and the equations of equilibrium available is only two. Horizontal equation we will not be able to adopt. So obviously it is 4 minus of 2 being 2, 2 unknowns, and one more than 2 unknown is 3. So 3 plastic hinges are there here. So 100% it is a true mechanism. And what the load you are going to get from this is the correct load. So now kindly see the external work. The external work done by the load is again the load getting pushed by an amount delta, where delta, as I mentioned earlier, it is L by 2 into theta. So W L by 2 theta, W L theta by 2. So this is not going to change in this particular case also, compared to the case of a simply supported beam, because no change as far as W is concerned, whether it is simply supported or even fixed. But what is important is to identify the internal work done by the plastic hinge. So in the simply supported beam, we had only one plastic hinge. So that plastic hinge with that MP undergoes the deformation of theta plus theta. So that is what I have written here. But now here we have a plastic hinge to the right, and also we have a plastic hinge to the left, and the portion of the beam with that moment carrying capacity undergoes theta as the rotation, and here also the MP undergoes theta rotation. So MP into theta, MP into theta. So that is what the addition. But in case of a simply supported beam, we had theta at both ends, but that was a mechanical hinge and no MP concept. So theta, theta, but now here theta with MP. So MP theta, MP theta is the two additional things that need to be considered compared to the previous problem of simply supported. So this is what the simply supported problem I am showing you again. So we have the answer for MP by L as W, but now here, so we have the slightly a different answer when you equate the external work to the internal work. External work, W is equal to L theta by 2, and that is equal to 4 MP theta. With that, W is equal to 8 MP theta. So just for curiosity, see in what way this particular problem is different compared to the previous. In previous, no change in the loading condition, the beam is simply supported. How much of load it carries? 4 MP by L. So for a given beam of MP, where MP is known for that beam, and for a given span, let it be any span, MP by L is constant, you can make out here. So W is 4 times of constant. But for the same constant, if the beam is transformed into a fixed beam, then it will become 8 into that constant. So previous case, it is 4 into constant, now here it is 8 into constant, means the load carrying capacity of the fixed beam is 2 times compared to the load carrying capacity of the same beam when it is treated as simply supported. Now what is the practical advantage? So there is no point in designing the beam as simply supported. So it's only from the point of academic interest, but otherwise if you see any beam in a multi-story building, whether it is RCC or PSC or any other type, definitely the advantage of continuity will be taken. So when you make the simply supported beam as a continuous beam in a multi-story building, the load carrying capacity of that beam increases substantially. But when you have a multi-story building made of steel, where the continuous member is connected by welding or by providing certain number of bolts, where the end is really acting like a rigid, similar to what happens in an RCC, so then also the load carrying capacity of the beam is twice. So thereby 8 MP by L comes into picture. So at the time of connection in a beam, where connection is really not rigid, where you have not provided welding, nor certain number of minimum bolts are not provided, even though the beam appears to be continuous, the end may not develop the appropriate resistance to the moment. It looks like a continuous beam, and the beam may not be a continuous beam. So in that situation, even though it is continuous in nature, the number of bolts are substantially less, where the required resistance for the moment is not going to develop, where MP is not going to be realized, then the W is equal to same as that of the simply supported beam. So 4 MP by L, because beam is simply supported from the consideration of the structural behavior. Otherwise, it looks like a continuous. So these are all some of the things students should appreciate from the point of practicality as far as the design of steel structure is concerned, and especially in the joint design, from the point of continuity, we need to provide certain minimum number of bolts. Otherwise, it has to be a strong welding. Thereby, it is rigid and able to transfer appropriate moments. Now, let us see the concept of redistribution of moments. So, it is not an easy concept. So, we have considered the fixed beam. Kindly see here. So, in this particular case, what happens is, from the point of formation of the moment. So, kindly see here, this is MP. So this is also MP, so this is also MP, and what is the total moment? So the total moment is equal to WL by 4. Now whenever you have a beam carrying a concentrated load at the center, and when you make the beam fixed, and what is the end moment you are going to get? So in the elastic condition, the end moment is WL by 8. So this is what you have appreciated, and when that load becomes maximum, that is W, even in that case the end load will be WL by 8, the end moment. And if you see the positive moment, so that is again equal to WL by 8. So this is the WL by 8 being the positive moment. So WL by 8 being the negative moments at the end means all the moments, the two end moments and the central moment, from the point of magnitude, whether it is the working stress method of analysis or even the ultimate load method of analysis. So these three locations will have the same value of moment under the elastic condition, and as you increase the load, so the load reaches W simultaneously. Thereby, at all these three locations, the plastic hinges are going to come simultaneously. So the question of one or two plastic hinges coming, and later after you apply additional load, the third hinge is likely to form, is not the case in this particular fixed beam subjected to a concentrated load. So here also there is a distribution of moment from elastic to plastic. So what additional load and what additional moment beyond the elastic we will be considering. So that's what the advantage of the method is all about. But the behavior of a fixed beam subjected to UDL over a span, and behavior of the same beam when the load is concentrated at the center, then the behavior is slightly different, and the three plastic hinges will not come simultaneously, and two plastic hinges will come at the end, and subsequently the third plastic hinge is going to come. So this is where the redistribution of bending moment in case of a fixed beam subjected to UDL comes into picture. So I just want to explain that particular concept. So in the fixed beam, so W is equal to 8 MP by L. So that's what I have written here. In other words, the maximum bending what you are going to get as WL by 8, and this W is the total load on a fixed beam because it's not the intensity of the load. So that is where you need to identify what is the intensity. So W is equal to say 10 kilonewton per meter. So thereby intensity comes into picture. So 10 kilonewton per meter, where the total span of the beam is say 4 meter, 10 into 4 is what the total load. So I have derived the expression in case of UDL as a function of the total load. It is not the intensity. So whenever you have the intensity, say small WU, and if that has a numerical value, so that need to be multiplied with the span so that you are going to get the ultimate load. So ultimate load as kilonewton is what is considered in the derivation. So this is known to you from the previous slide. Now let us see what happens to the distribution of the bending moment. So in the elastic condition, this is the elastic condition of the beam, the same fixed beam, and we know that the end moment, so in case of a fixed beam with UDL, not with concentrated load, with UDL, so that is small W intensity L square by 12. So W L square by 12 is what we have seen, but here I have multiplied the intensity with the span, so that is the reason it is WY L by 12. So multiplication with this span comes into picture, but otherwise the load is always be working. So WY L by 2, so WL by 12 is what the fixed moment. So what is the meaning of Y? So this is the condition corresponding to the onset of the first yielding. So that is the end of the elastic behavior, and anything beyond that, so we have the plastic behavior. Now corresponding to this WL by 12 and WL by 12, and if you see the entire bending moment in a simply supported beam, so that is WL by 4. If that is what the situation, so corresponding to the load W, corresponding to the, sorry, the load WY, which causes the end to have a moment of MY, what is the moment at the center? The central moment is not equal to WL by 12. It is substantially less than that, because this is WYL by 8. So WL by 8, that is what is known to you, and this is WL by 12. So obviously when you subtract one from the other, so this value if you calculate, it is WL by 24. So what is the interpretation of this? So whenever you have a fixed beam subjected to UDL, and when the load is elastic, say you have some load, say W, then the end moment is WL by 12, and the central positive moment is WL by 24. The central bending moment being positive is always be less by 50% compared to the end moment, or the end moment WL by 12 is always greater. It is twice that of the central positive moment. So positive moment is less, negative moment is more. Negative moment is two times the positive moment, or the positive moment is of the negative moment. So this is what the condition corresponding to the onset of yielding as far as the two ends are concerned. Now if you increase the load on the beam beyond whatever you have already applied, so the moment at the end also increases. So this MY increases, so thereby the distribution of the stress over the depth become elastic plastic. So at the extreme fibers it is plastic, and then near the core it becomes elastic. So you have plastic elastic or elastic plastic distribution of the stress, and when you see here, it is still about to yield, or it might have just started to yield. Now you increase the load further, then what happens? So the elastic plastic distribution increases, the plastic behavior increases, the elastic behavior will become lesser and lesser, and maybe at that instant of time, so this particular moment may reach the yield moment, may reach the yield moment where the extreme fiber near the center have attained FY. But if you increase the load further, my dear students, kindly see what happens. So there is a possibility that the elastoplastic moment transform itself into a fully plastified moment. The entire cross section, whatever you have here, so that will attain the value of MP, and of course this also will attain the value of MP. So at that particular instant of time, if you measure the value of the moment near the center, that will not be equal to MP. So it will definitely be less than MP. Maybe it is WY, so it may be MY, or it may be the moment capacity, depending on what type of distribution of stress you have here at the center, it may be elastic plastic moment. But what I want to tell you at this instant of time, in a fixed beam with UDL, so the two ends of the beam will develop the plastic hinge first. Corresponding to that situation, if you see the center, there is no plastic hinge. Now you need to increase the load further, then what happens? Already the ends have attained the plastic moment. There is no scope for those moments to increase. The end is not able to offer any resistance to the moment. So obviously the end tends to rotate as you apply the load UDL, but the moment near the center increases, because you are increasing the load. Obviously the burden has to be transferred to the low beam, and the beam has to carry the additional moment, and only the central portion of the beam, which is not completely yielded, start to resist the load. So thereby the moment carrying capacity near the center keep on increases further and further. But at the end, the moment cannot increase because it is already empty, but the portion near the support having certain length, being the length of the plastic injured the support, that continues to rotate further and further, and with the increase in load further, so this particular value at the center might reach MP, where the entire cross section has plastified. So by the time the central cross section completely plastifies, the end two end cross sections which have already plastified undergoes continuous rotation, and now one more plastic hinge is likely to come at the center. Now if you increase the load further, so the ends already being plastified and undergone certain rotation cannot offer any resistance, and even the center also cannot offer resistance because it has already reached MP. Now the beam with three plastic hinges undergoes continuous rotation leading to the failure. So that is where the concept of mechanism with three hinges comes into picture. Now what is the type of bending moment diagram? So this is what the plastic bending moment diagram corresponding to the collapse. The two ends we have the MP, and the center also we have the MP. What is the meaning? MP plus MP, 2MP. 2MP is equal to WL by 12, where W is W. So with that we get, so WL by 16, and this is what the formula we have already discussed in the earlier case, where W is equal to 8MP by L. So this is where the redistribution of bending moment comes into picture. So this is where the final redistribution leading to the mechanism. So with MP, MP and MP. So this is the condition at the verge of failure. But please remember, the first two plastic hinges will come at the end simultaneously, but the third plastic hinge is not going to come. And finally, the third plastic hinge will come, and by that time these two ends will undergo further rotation. Now any increase in load is not possible because all the three locations will undergo further and further rotation. So that's where the mechanism. The same problem, fix it, but if you have a concentrated load at the center, in fact we have seen it, there also we need to have three plastic hinges. The fixed bending moment diagram is not going to change. So the free bending moment diagram, in fact here it is parabolic, there it will become triangular, but all the three locations will attain the plastic hinges simultaneously. No redistribution of moment after the formation of the plastic hinges. But here two plastic hinges, and then further improvement in the load carrying capacity and the moment carrying capacity. So that will be resisted by the central portion, and subsequently the third hinge will form, and with that we have the failure mechanism. Now let us see what is the additional load, the burden the beam is going to carry beyond the onset of the yielding till it undergoes failure. So that is where the substantial increase in the load carrying capacity of the fixed beam with UDL comes into picture. To appreciate this, I have taken the same beam. So WYL by 8 is what the total bending moment at the center, and that moment as a function of MY is MY plus MY by 2. So you please go to the previous slide. So this is what the moment MY, WL by 12, and this being WL by 24, in terms of the moment MY, it is half of MY. So MY plus half MY is what this entire depth is. So 1.5 times of MY equal to this WYL by 8 is what the condition corresponding to the elastic bending moment diagram. That's what I have written here. Now the free bending moment WL by 8, that's what I have written here also. The fixed moment, so WL by 12 being negative, so the positive is the free moment. The net bending moment, so WYL by 8 minus of WYL by 12, that is equal to WYL by 24. So please remember this particular thing. Net fixed end moment, WL by 12. The two negative moments, so which I have shown, so that is WL by 12. Now substitute the value of MY plus of MY is 1.5 MY, so that is equal to WYL by 8 Now with this, what is WY? So WY is equal to 12MYL. So straight away we will be able to get this particular information. So there is no change. So only one equation will give you the value of yield load, the load on the beam as a UDL corresponding to the onset of yield. Now we also have the relation, the ultimate load divided by the working load. So that is equal to, the ultimate load is directly proportional to the moment corresponding to that ultimate load. So that being the plastic moment capacity. So that is 16 MPa by L. But what is this WY? So that is what we have just calculated based on the elastic stress distribution. So elastic distribution of the bend moment over the span, and that is 12 MY by L. So 13 MPa by L, 12 MY by L. So if you calculate that, that is 1.33 into MP by MY. So LL goes to docks. Now what is this MP by MY? So fully plastic capacity of the section divided by the capacity of the section corresponding to the onset of the yielding. So that is where the shape factor comes into picture, and depending on the shape of the cross section, the shape factor will vary. And in fact, we have seen in case of a rolled section, that if the section is I section, it varies from 1.1 going up to 1.15, maybe with an average of 1.12 we can consider. So 1.33 into 1.12, it is 1.493, that can be rounded up to 1.5. So what is the meaning of this? So WU by WY is equal to 1.5. What is W? That is the ultimate load. What is WY? It is the load on the beam corresponding to the first yielding. So from the first yielding situation to the entire beam undergoing a failure by mechanism, where three hinges are going to come, what is the additional load you are going to put on the beam is the criteria. It is not the load factor. It is the interpretation is different. The ultimate load which causes the collapse compared to the situation where the extreme fiber at any location has just started to yield in a fixed beam with UDL. So that is 1.5. What is the meaning of this? Ultimate load is almost 50% more compared to the yield load causing the failure, or the load causing the first yield. But in a working stress condition, the load what you are going to apply can be equal to WY, or it can be anything less than WY. So that is where you are identifying the factor of safety corresponding to any location along the elastic behavior. But WY corresponding to the end of the elastic behavior, but your actual working condition where you are allowing the permissible value of the stress, the load is permissible load, and that permissible load is the allowable load, and that load is always be less than the load corresponding to the yield, because the yield is not permitted in case of a working stress method of analysis. So it is only the relationship between the ultimate load causing the failure by mechanism corresponding to the load which causes the yielding of the just yielding of the cross section, which is really at the end of the beam as far as fixed beam is concerned. Now let us see some of the problems on the plastic section modulus. So the plastic section modulus is very important, otherwise it is not possible to determine the shape factor. So the shape factor, as you know, it is the plastic section modulus which is always be more compared to the elastic section modulus. So plastic section modulus by elastic section modulus, and that is equal to plastified moment divided by the yield moment. So that's where the plastic section modulus to elastic section modulus comes into picture. Now let us continue further. Let us take some problems on plastic section modulus. So let us consider the rectangular beam. In fact, so this has been discussed in greater detail in one of the earlier classes, where the width of the rectangular beam is small b, overall depth is d. So of the portion above the equal area axis and of below the equal area axis, and the center of the top area and the bottom area at a distance of d by 4, all these things have told you. So with this, what is the plastic section modulus with respect to zz? So please see here, The horizontal axis is referred to as the ZZ axis. But if you see, the width is more, the depth, width is less, the depth is more. So what is this ZZ axis? ZZ axis is again the symmetric axis, about which what is the second moment of area, the moment of inertia of the suction? The moment of inertia of the suction is B dQ by 12. So where D is more than B, and we are cubing the depth which is more. So obviously B D cube by 12 is substantially more compared to the B D cube by 12 with respect to the other axis. What is the first axis? This is the first axis where depth is more, and that is a symmetric axis. And if you see the another symmetric axis YY, so as far as the bending with respect to YY is concerned, so what is the second moment of area? Being the second moment of area or moment of inertia. So that is again D B cube by 12. So it's the same formula, B D cube by 12. Now that B is becoming D, D is becoming B. So larger depth, larger width into smaller depth cube by 12. So the numerical value is substantially smaller because we are cubing the smaller dimension B. So obviously the moment of inertia with respect to YY is substantially less because you are cubing B. But here the moment of inertia with respect to horizontal is substantially higher because we are cubing D, the depth. By chance, if you have an example of a beam cross section with 200 by 400. So in one case, you are cubing 400, and in the second case, you are cubing 200. So 400 into 200 cube by 12, 200 into 400 cube by 12. So if you calculate and see by how much the moment of inertia with respect to ZZ is more, it's not just by an order of 2, 3, 4, 5 times. Sometimes it is 20 times, 30 times, 50 times, 100 times, depending on how you are going to define the cross section. But in case of a rectangular beam, the moment of inertia with respect to the major principal axis, so major principal axis is also called as the major symmetric axis, and this is the minor symmetric axis or the minor principal axis, about which the moments of inertia are either maximum or minimum. In such situation of a rectangle, so the maximum value may be 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, 10 times, depending on the size. But when you have a rolled section which is made of plates, and in that situation, the major moment of inertia with respect to ZZ is 50 times, 100 times, 200 times greater compared to the moment of inertia with respect to the another orthogonal axis. So the bending resistance of an I section is quite substantial with respect to the major axis. So that is the reason many a times we keep the I section in the way we see. So when we see the I section in a building, so the cross section, if you see with respect to the span and with respect to the direction of the load, being the transverse load, the way the beam bends is such that we are utilizing the major moment of inertia. The load carrying capacity is quite substantial. So that is where moment with respect to one plane comes into picture. By chance, if there exists a moment with respect to other plane also, because the other plane, so the moment of inertia is substantially less, so it may undergo failure by buckling. So when you have a beam as an I section, you have to use the beam in I form only. By chance, if you put it in the other direction where the section looks like an H, then also the beam resists load, but the load carrying capacity will be substantially smaller. And another important thing is if you see the polar moment of inertia of the I section. So moment of inertia with respect to ZZ is 200 times, but with respect to Y is just one time. So the polar moment of inertia, so being the summation of the orthogonal moments of inertia, it is just 201. So 201 is almost close to 200, means the behavior of such type of I-beam is mainly controlled by IZZ, and it is really not able to carry any moment in the other direction. And by chance, if you apply the moment, the section fails in the lateral direction by buckling. So that is the reason. So I section is very strong with respect to major moment of inertia, and it is very weak with respect to the minor moment of inertia. So you have to apply only one moment with respect to major axis, and you can't subject I section to biaxial moment. And this is what the equation I have derived. So BD square by 4 being the ZPZ, and this is with respect to another axis ZPY. And what is shape factor? That you can calculate, because you also know what is the section modulus with respect to horizontal and section modulus with respect to vertical. In fact, it is very similar to the formula. Instead of BD square by 4, there we have BD square by 6. So BD square by 4 divided by BD square by 6 is 1.5. Or even with respect to the minor axis, DB square by 4 divided by DB cube by 6, again you are getting 1.5. So the shape factor is 1.5, and the importance of shape factor also I have told you in the previous class. So increase in moment carrying capacity from the point of first yielding to the complete plastification situation. So it is 50% more. So that is where shape factor is 1.5. Now let us see the shape factor as far as the other types of cross sections are concerned. So let us take one or two examples. Now this is what the square is, and here the square is kept in such a way that the major axis is passing through the diagonal and another axis is passing through through the centroid, but it is perpendicular in nature. So the two orthogonal axes comes here also. Then what is the moment of inertia of this section? The moment of inertia of the section, if you take along the symmetric axis, so this is what the symmetric axis, so we know it is BD cube by 12. So BD cube by 12, in this square it is a to the power of 4 by 12 through the centroid, which is parallel to the side being the symmetric axis. And also the value of I with respect to the centroidal axis, where the axis is parallel to another side. Both are the symmetric axis. Please remember, students, whenever you have a section like square where you are able to identify two symmetric axes, so that is true in this case. So we have one symmetric axis and we have another symmetric axis, about which the second moment of area or the moment of inertia is a to the power 4 by 12. That is constant. So whenever you have two axes about which the second moment of area is constant and the axes are passing through the centroid, you take any other axis through the centroid and that axis also will have the same second moment of area. So now I need the second moment of area with respect to this axis, moment of inertia. So what is the moment of inertia of this? So you can calculate the second moment of inertia from the first principle also, which I will be explaining in a short while. But going by this principle, so the moment of inertia with respect to ZZ means IZ, that is equal to A to the power of 4 by 12, and that's what I told. So with respect to symmetric axis, B D cube by 12, so B and D are same, equal to A, it is A 4 by 12. So you write the importance of the two symmetric axes passing through the centroid, and then see with respect to any other axis the moment of inertia is same. Otherwise you can calculate the moment of inertia of the triangle. So you know the moment of inertia of the triangle, so derived with respect to the base, that is also known to you, derived with respect to the centroidal axis, which is at a depth of height by 3 from the base. So through this point, what is the moment of inertia? That is known to you. And also what is the moment of inertia along the horizontal axis? So that is also known to you. So since we have two such triangles, one above and one below, so I can add the moment of inertia. So that is what you find in many of the textbooks. Now with the dimensions being given, where the side is A and this is A, in fact this is more compared to the two sides of the triangle. Kindly see this triangle. So the vertical ordinate and the horizontal axis being the resolved component of the linear vector A. So this is smaller compared to A. This is again smaller compared to A. They are equal. But as a function of A, what is this? So whenever you have a square with 90 degree inclination, please remember the smaller dimension is 0.707 times of A. So that is nothing but A by root 2. So because A square is, so this distance square plus this distance square from the Pythagoras theorem. So obviously this depth is a by root 2. Root 2, as you know, it is 1.412. If you take it to the numerator, it is 0.707. So if this is a, this is 0.707. Where is the centroid located? The centroid is located at this particular point, which is at a distance of 1 by 3 of that height, being a by root 2. So that also I have written it here. So you can calculate the moment of inertia with respect to this axis. And with respect to the centroidal axis, it is always the minimum. And if you go away from the axis, maybe if instead of this horizontal axis through this point, if you take the horizontal axis through the base, because that axis is away from the centroidal axis, obviously the value of the moment of inertia increases. And that is what the value. So you have here. So kindly see here, the moment of inertia about the horizontal ZZ axis as far as the top triangle is concerned. Only the top triangle. So you please remove this two. It is A. What is that A? A is this width. So this horizontal width is nothing but this is A, and this horizontal width is always be more than A. Now you take this triangle, the bigger triangle, again that is rectangular in nature. So A square plus A square under the root is what this horizontal distance. So this horizontal distance is more than A, and this vertical or the horizontal distance is less than A. So in one case it is A by root 2, and this is actually A root 2. Root 2 is 1.414. So 1.414 times of A is what this horizontal distance. Now B d cube by 12. So B is root 2 A is B d cube. So d is a by root 2 cube by 12. So what is that you have here? Removing 2. So this value, what I have shown here, is nothing but b d cube by 12. The moment of inertia of the triangle with respect to the base. But if you calculate with respect to the centroidal axis, it is 36. So whatever the value you know, you have to use it, and then parallaxis theorem comes into picture, and then you have to transfer it onto this axis. Again, if you do it like that, you are getting the moment of inertia with respect to the base of the triangle, where the triangle is the top one. And similarly, if you take the bottom one, so we need to add the same amount of moment of inertia value. So then it becomes 2 times of that, and with that it is A4 by 12. So whether you go by the fundamental principle, or if you use the concept of the moment of inertia with respect to the orthogonal axis being symmetric, and then through any other axis again passing through the centroid, so we have the same moment of inertia. So anyway, so the value of Iz is known. And what is the extreme fiber? The extreme fiber is the point B, or even the point D, which is at a distance of A by root 2. So obviously, what is elastic section modulus? So the elastic section modulus is nothing but the moment of inertia with respect to horizontal axis Iz. So that is a by a to the power 4 by 12. And what is the extreme fiber distance? That is a by root 2. And that's what the a by root 2 I have written here. And with this, it is a cube divided by 6 root 2. So this is the elastic section modulus of the cross section. Whenever the distribution happens to be elastic in nature, and if you want to calculate the moment of resistance, then you need this section modulus. And when you go to the full plastification of the section, where the stress distribution over the section is completely FY, where each and every fiber has yielded, the plastic section modulus is given by this particular formula, where we need to take 50% of the area either above or below the equal area axis. And we need to multiply that with the summations of the two distances. So where the centroid of the top area and bottom area is concentrated. So that is where this distance comes into picture. So what is this distance? So this distance is nothing but A divided by 3 root 2. So what is the area? The area of this particular section with side A, obviously area is A square. So 50% of area is a square by 2, that is what I have written here, the same thing, into y1 bar plus y2 bar. So y1 bar, you know, this is the value, similar value, you can write it here, a by 3 root 2 plus a by 3 root 2, and with this, the simplification, we have a cube by 3 root 2. So a cube by 3 root 2 is the plastic section modulus, which is always be higher compared to the elastic section modulus. If you compare these two, So the only difference here we have 6, here we have 3, but obviously this divided by this. So because 3 it is in the in the denominator of the denominator, so here the denominator of the denominator will become 6, and that will go to the numerator if you divide ZPZ by ZEZ. So ZPZ is this, a cube by 3 root 2, the whole upon a cube by 6 root 2. So that is 6 by 3 being 2. So what is the shape factor? The shape factor in case of a square which is resting on the edge, where the diagonal is horizontal. If that is the case, then the shape factor is 2. So let us stop at this stage, my dear students. So we will continue with many more problems in the next class. So if you have any questions, so you can ask as far as the today's class, or even with respect to the previous classes, so that I can answer. So I can also send the questions to my email ID, so I'll be responding to your questions. Thank you very much, my dear friends. I will stop at this stage. Have a good day.